being June 4th, 2018, after the hour of 7 o'clock, I'll call the meeting to order. The first order of business is on a motion to admit. Can you hear me now? It being June 4th, 2018, after the hour of 7 o'clock, I call this meeting to order. The first order of business is a motion to admit guest Mr. Schultz.
Can you guys hear me? Mr. Moderator, I move that the following persons be admitted to the meeting: Darren Klein, Maureen Doherty, Janet Murphy, Carol Ducro, Jessica Barty, Amy Luckowitz, Harold Miller, Allison Kane, Susan Magner, Helen Crawford, Laura Crawford, Rob Carbone, Jason Smith, Matthew Cooper, Sharon Kelleher, Debbie Carbone, Marianne McKay, Mark Clark, John Klippel, Maureen Stevens, Robert Williamson, Mike Murphy, Vincenzo Studo, Michael Connolly, Jerry Noel, Danielle McKnight, James Collins, Jordan Rudolph, John Bernard, and Michaela Christoph.
We have a motion to admit. Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? The visit is manned to the hall. While they're entering, I'll cover a couple of orders of business. The tellers for tonight, if we need a hand count, the center section, Sean Delaney. My right, Ed McGrath. The front, and my left, Lori Capizzuto. All registered voters should be wearing an aqua ribbon. All visitors are wearing a black ribbon. Please turn off your cell phones so as not to interrupt the meeting. There are microphones in the center of each aisle, and then there are runners at the top and the bottom for each side. If you're seeking recognition this evening, you must be recognized by the moderator before you speak. After you're recognized to speak, if you have a follow-up question, please raise your hand and I will recognize you again. You can't just maintain a dialogue with the person who answers your question. If you're responding to a question, please make sure you are recognized to speak. When I call on those in the audience, I need your name and address for the record before you speak. I'd like to thank our student volunteers this evening, Maddie Curry, Brandon DeClean, Jake Stats, and Zach Stats. Thank you very much in advance. And again, if you need the microphone brought to you, raise your hand and it'll be brought to you. If you'd like, you can go to the center of each aisle. There is a microphone there. Mr. Prisco, a point of personal privilege. Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Thank you. Pledge of allegiance.
Please rise. Thank you. I'd just like to take a minute before we get started to recognize a few people that have just recently left their boards and their committees. I want to take a moment to recognize Mr. Jerry Venezia for his years in the school committee, secondary school building committee, and board of selection, Julie Conkey for her time on the school committee, and Mr. Joe Vino of the CPC, Housing Authority, and board of selection. We thank you for your service to the town
You certainly left your fingerprints everywhere you have worked. We thank you for your dedication. I'd like to please take a moment and recognize him as a round of applause. If you're here this evening, if you can stand up, I'd like to see you. You certainly deserve a standing ovation. It's not easy to do what we do. It's a lot of work, a lot of hours away from the family, and your dedication will never be forgotten. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll entertain a motion to dispense with the reading of the warrant. Ms. Manuelle.
Mr. Moderator, I move to dispense with the reading of the warrant and refer to the articles by number, and further to dispense with the reading of the return of service by the constable.
We have the motion. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Ms. Manupelli, Article 1.
Article 1, fiscal year 2018 budget amendment. Mr. Moderator, I move to amend line 106 parks and recreation expenses in the fiscal year 2018 omnibus budget, voted under Article 15 of the June 5th, 2017 town meeting, by appropriating $8,582.63 to be funded with parks and recreation retained earnings.
I have a motion. This is a technology grant. That happened before. I have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation?
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation? Mrs. Silver.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Before we get to Article 2, if anybody does not have a warrant and would like one, raise your hand. I have folks up the back who will bring one down to you. So if you need a warrant to follow along, just raise your hand. Thank you. Ms. Manuelle, Article 2.
Article 2.
This one's on Article 2.
Fiscal year 2018 snow and ice deficit.
Yes, Captain, hold on. I got a runner coming to you.
Article 2 is to fund the fiscal year 2018 snow and ice deficit. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $48,000 to fund the deficit in the fiscal year 2018 snow and ice budget as specified in Article 2 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation?
Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Silver.
Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 3, Ms. Mangiapelli.
Article 3 is to fiscal year 2018 appropriate funds to capital improvement stabilization fund. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $850,000 and transfer from sale of town land the sum of $250,000 for a total of $1,100,000 to be added to the capital improvement stabilization fund established under Article 5 of the October 2017 town meeting specified in Article 3 as printed in warrant.
Did you mean 2007, not 17?
Sorry, 2007.
Thank you. We have a motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mrs. Minion, please.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
The Finance Committee, Ms. Stover.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 4, Ms. Mangiapelli. Ms. Yule. I didn't hear. Motion carries. I set the record straight. Article 4, Ms. Mangiapelli.
Article 4 is fiscal year 2018 transfer funds to water stabilization fund. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from fiscal year 2018 water tap entertainer in the sum of $1,001,902 to be added to water stabilization fund as specified in Article 4 as printed in warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Ms. Mangiapelli.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Stover.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion carries. Article 5, Ms. Mangiapelli.
Article 5 is a fiscal year 2018 appropriate money to stabilization fund. Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 5 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Ms. Mangiapelli.
Board of Selectmen recommends pass over.
The Finance Committee, Ms. Stover.
Finance Committee recommends passing on.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 6.
Article 6 is the fiscal year 2018 transfer funds to other post-employment benefits liability trust fund. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from pensions and benefits line 30 of the fiscal year 2018 operating budget voted under Article 15 of the June 5th, 2017 town meeting, the sum of $250,000 to be added to other post-employment benefits liability trust fund established under Article 36 of the June 3rd, 2013 town meeting as specified in Article 6 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Ms. Mangiapelli.
Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Stover.
Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 7, Ms. Mangiapelli.
Article 7 is fiscal year 2018 transfer funds to solid waste stabilization fund. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from solid waste management line 50 in the in the fiscal year 2018 non-operating budget voted under Article 15 of the June 5th, 2017 town meeting, the sum of $12,000 to be added to the solid waste stabilization fund established under Article 23 of the April 2006 town meeting as specified in Article 7 as printed in the warrant.
We have a motion for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Minipelli.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Solder.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 8. Mr. Schultz.
Article 8, Select Town Offices. Mr. Moderator, I move to authorize the Board of Selectmen to choose all necessary town officers not elected by ballot and to determine what instructions shall be given.
We have a motion, recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Schultz.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Solder.
There's no action required.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 9, Mr. Schultz.
Article 9, hear and act on reports of town officers and committees. Mr. Moderator, I move to accept the printed town report for the year 2017 as a report of the town officers and committees. It is here a report that may be presented at this meeting.
I know we have several people giving reports, so I'll wait for the recommendations from the selectmen until I'd like to give the reports.
The Board of Selectmen recommend.
For the Finance Committee, do you have a report? Ms. Hogan.
Good evening. There's a bit of a change in the warrant, which you probably noticed. You'll find that the report of the Finance Committee is found on page 7 as opposed to inside the front page. In short, we continue to be concerned about tight money and escalating costs of providing level services to the town. The cost of goods and services continue to outpace revenues. It was impossible to fund all the budget requests this year. The big budget drivers continue to be salaries and health care. It has been an eventful year with several major projects that come into fruition, especially on the sale of the very property and the successful negotiation of a long-term water contract with the annual, which, by the way, was unanimously voted by the Board of Selectmen of the Sea. We are very fortunate through the diligence and perseverance of the Board of Selectmen, the Capital Planning Committee, and the Economic Development Committee, as well as other committees and officials, that the very property sale has been completed and full townhouses are starting construction on this time of development. In the coming years, this development will bring increased tax relief, offering some relief to the town. While the town received almost $20 million for the sale of this land, it is an ongoing increased tax revenue which will benefit the town for years to come. Please note that the build-out of this development will take at least another 3 to 4 years. It is very important for all to understand and remember that the actual money for the sale of the land is a one-time event. The use of these funds, the sale of town on the land, is by law restricted to capital items with a useful life of at least 5 years or more and debt service. These monies must be protected and used wisely in ways such as leveraging borrowing for infrastructure. It is unlikely that our town will see such a large sum again in the near future. Through the hard work of the Board of Selectmen represented by Stephen O'Leary and Bob Zeri, the town administrator and Mark Clark of the Water Department, the town has successfully negotiated a 99-year contract with the town of Andover for a supply of quality water. Investigating Andover water and the Andover possibilities has been a long, arduous task, and those involved are to be recognized and thanked for their numerous hours of exhaustive study and negotiation. This substantial project comes with an initial price tag, but it is a hope that the project will offer North Reading the security and quality of water on a consistent basis for years to come. The CIPC Capital Committee has approved various large capital projects for 2019 to the Board of Selectmen. The Capital Committee works to recommend immediate projects while keeping our bonding at a manageable level. The committee must decide which projects need immediate funding and which requests can await future funding. In making these decisions, costs of postponement, town safety, and the effect on the capital budget are all major considerations. You will be asked to vote on the capital budget in Article 15. Approved projects and their funding source may be found with the warrant article. Also important, the Finance Committee recommends that the Tax Stabilization Fund be maintained at 5% of net revenue. I realize that we voted to postpone adding to the Stabilization Fund at this town meeting. Currently, the fund is at approximately 4%. The purpose of this fund is to protect the town in a true emergency and to help sustain our operating, demonstrating the financial health of the town. No monies will be added at this town meeting, nor have they been added in recent memory in the last several years. We must seriously consider adding to the fund on a regular basis going forward. Our thanks to many individuals who have elected and appointed from the municipal, school departments, and various town committees for their work in making the hard decisions necessary during this budget process. Thank you.
Mr. Webster for the Athletic Facilities Committee.
Good evening, everyone. Just wanted to give a quick update on the Athletic Facilities project at the turf field. The restroom and concessions building was completed on time, which is under budget and on budget. I think that's good. I'm going to be better. It's got a lot of use already. Hosted two state track meets, and we're going to get a lot of use Friday night at graduation. And I'd just like to thank all the community members who've been in a lot of time and effort to get that building completed. And as far as I'm concerned, that athletic facility over there, from the street all the way up to school, is a sign.
Mr. McGrath. For the Recycling Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Good evening, I'm Ed McGrath. I'm a longtime member of the North Reading Recycling Committee and full head of hair when I started. I was asked to give a presentation about the town's recycling program tonight and the recent developments that will affect us all. The recycling industry has changed dramatically since last June. The old adage, think globally, act locally, still rings true today. The global perspective. Last June, China announced its national sword policy to halt the flow of garbage coming into their country under the guise of recyclable materials. And they established a contamination level of 0.5%. One challenge, challenge. We don't know what the contamination is, what the definition is. A byproduct of this policy is simple, economics. With China's market closed, there is a glut of supply on the market. The markets are smaller. That is, there aren't any markets that to replace the volume China was importing. And as a result, the prices for recycled materials have fallen. This policy has changed the business model on the East Coast and required the U.S. Recycling Committee to change the ways it does business. A little closer to home. In order to produce cleaner bales, MRFs, the material recovery facilities, are taking these measures and incurring increased costs. And while the costs are increasing, revenue is decreasing. MRFs used to generate enough revenue from the sale of materials that to cover their costs and to sort and bale materials. Not anymore. The change is MRFs are charging towns to sort, bale, and market their materials. There are municipalities in Massachusetts currently paying $80 to $90 a ton. Locally, starting July 1st, North Reading will be paying JRM $60 a ton to process its recyclables. This fee is going to cost the town between $60,000 and $75,000 in the next fiscal year. And this is why the trash fee was increased to $68 a quarter. Want to make one note, it will still cost more to burn trash than it is to process recycling. This slide is correct. That policy China initiated reaches your home. What you put in the recycling bin and what you don't impacts the whole process. Think of it as your recycling bin as the first link in some company's supply chain. What does not go in the bin are plastic bags filled with recyclables, plastic shopping bags and similar products like the case wraps for water, dry cleaning bags, or those air pillows that come with your Amazon boxes. As for food waste, we must rinse and empty all containers, whether metal, glass, or plastic. The example of why, a Chinese inspector opens a shipping container and the smell of rotted food, the door is closed and the whole container is rejected. What does go in the bin are empty and flattened cardboard boxes, mixed paper, magazines, newspapers, and paper you recycle all along. And think of this as containers, metal, plastic, and glass. And again, all those containers need to be rinsed and emptied. And just because a plastic item has that recycling symbol on it, it doesn't mean it goes in the bin. For instance, number 6 plastics or styrofoam or food trays goes in the trash, not in the recycling. Remember, if you put trash in the recycling bin, it's not recycling, it's trash. Before I go, these figures on the slide, I got an update late this afternoon from JRM. Compared to FY17, recycling is down 3%, and the amount of trash we send up to the incinerator is up just under 1%. Still, because of recycling, North Reading has avoided more than $80,000 in tip fees this fiscal year. To close, recycle right. Do not bag recyclables. It won't be taken. Empty and flatten your cardboard boxes, rinse and empty your containers, and recycle your water when you're done with that at the time. Thank you.
Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Mr.
McGrath, I think you have a question coming your way.
Mr. McGrath, another question for you?
Mr. Yule. Please go through the chair. We'll grab it from the podium. Reports. You Capital Committee report.
I'll keep this brief. Got a lot to do this evening. The Capital Improvement Planning Committee was formed by the Board of Selectmen about 6 years ago with the mission of reviewing all capital projects before the town and making recommendations annually to the Board of Selectmen. The committee is comprised of nine individuals representing the Board of Selectmen, the schools, the Finance Committee, and town government. We work a number of hours during the year looking at the projects and coming up with our recommendations. This past year, we had requests for about $2.3 million of capital expenditures from the municipal and school departments. After our review
and balancing out what we could afford, either through cash, or use of the stabilization fund, or bonding, we were able to recommend about two-thirds or $1.6 million of that to the Board of Selectmen, which they agreed to bring forward in the warrant. Key was keeping the debt service at a level that we've agreed to for the past several years, and not add anything to that, but just to replace what's there and use the stabilization fund keep it in balance, that we've been able to do that. You'll see in the warrant article 9 to 15 all of the items. I'm just going to go over a couple of the major items, and we can discuss some more at the warrant article for questions. But one of the biggest is the $350,000 item for the IMN. Comcast has taken away the IMN that we had. We had to fund the new IMN for all of the school and town buildings. So that has been recommended and will be at UBS for that tonight. And we'll be bonding that item. Another major item was the DDW building. The roof of the building was severely damaged. It had a lot of leaks in it, a lot of penetration to the insulation, water coming down to the building. Poses a risk to the equipment and the wet insulation, just not a good healthy situation. So we're recommending that as well. We're also recommending a new front end loader for the DDW. This will be to supplement a current piece of equipment that is aging and will be put into use for year-round snow removal, but also to use during the construction season to supplement the other equipment that we have. The road program, there is a recommendation of $300,000 for road work in town on accepted streets. That augments $815,000 in Chapter 90 money that we get from the state. So we've got a little over $1 million in money to spend on roads. And we need every nickel. Roads in town have deteriorated somewhat over the last 7 years. We've got about 22 road miles, which is about a quarter of the roads in town, that are either in reconstruction or reclamation state, which is they need work. But the money can't all just go there. It also needs to go to roads that are in good shape now. We need to keep them in good shape so they don't fall into this category. So if there is money next year, then I think the committee would be in favor of increasing the amount of money put into roads. See if we can't get ahead of this because we're not making a lot of our investment at the moment. There are a lot of projects on the horizon. We not only look at the current fiscal year, but we look out the next 3 years as well. Departments have identified over $8 million in projects valued at $100,000 more. That's an addition to the small projects. So there's a lot of things that are going to be coming up before the committee. We're not obviously going to be able to afford to do all of those in the next 3 years. And if you went on 3 more years, you should see some other major items. So the committee will be working diligently on those to investigate them, to vet the proposed expenditure, to make recommendations to select so we can keep our capital program operating as current as possible.
Mr. Kelleher, I'm sorry, but you need to wrap it up.
The other items that we looked at with Parks and Rec, that are small items we approved, and then there are a couple of water items that also come up that need to be done, irrespective of which direction we want to be able to go. This is going to be an article. Thank you.
Any other committee reports? After hearing all the reports, does the Board of Selectmen have a recommendation? Mr. Schultz?
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
The Finance Committee, Mr. Sullivan?
Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye. Opposed? Unanimous. Article 10. Mr. Schultz?
Article 10, authorized director of public works to accept easements. Mr. Moderator, I move to authorize the director of Department of Public Works to accept easements on behalf of the town as specified in Article 10, as printed in this warrant.
We have a motion that the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation. Mr. Schultz?
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mr. Sullivan?
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. I'd just like to make one comment. We have a very full agenda. We have 40 articles on the warrant tonight. That's more than I can remember in many, many years. So in order to keep things moving along, I will be timing speakers. So I will interrupt and give the speaker warning that they need to wrap it up. And at that point, we have about 30 seconds to finish up. So it's just in order to keep things moving along. Mr. Schultz, Article 11.
Article 11, authorized treasurer to enter into compensating balance agreements. Mr. Moderator, I move to authorize the treasurer to enter into compensating balance agreements as specified in Article 11 as printed in the warrant.
We have a motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Schultz?
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
The Finance Committee, Mr. Silver?
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 12, Mr. Schultz?
Article 12, authorized Chapter 90 Highway Construction Funds. Mr. Moderator, I move to appropriate such sum as may be allotted from the Chapter 90 apportionment on other state roadway reimbursement programs for the purposes of constructing, reconstructing, or maintaining roadways within the town of North Reading as specified in Article 12 as printed in the warrant.
We have a motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to recommend? Mr. Schultz?
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
Finance Committee wishes to recommend. Mr. Schultz?
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 13, Mr. Schultz.
Article 13, prior year bills. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from the fiscal year 2018 omnibus line 47 DPW snow and ice expenses to the sum of $1,360 to pay bills for the prior year. The transfer from fiscal year 2018 on the bus line 96 water enterprise expenses, the sum of $576 to pay bills of the prior year, and to transfer from fiscal year 2018 on the bus line 30 pensions and benefits expenses, the sum of $7,067 to pay bills of the final year, to pay bills of the prior year, as specified in Article 13 as printed in the warrant.
On the motion, does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Schultz?
Yes, the Board of Selectmen recommends.
Mr. Sullivan?
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? This requires a 4-5 vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 14, Mr. Schultz.
Article 14, this is motion number one on the fiscal year 2019 operating budget. Mr. Moderator, I move to raise and appropriate transfer the sum set forth in the column headed Selectmen Recommended in the line items 1 through 112, excluding line 99, debt service, including the transfer of other funds, all as set forth in the budget detail dated June 4, 2018, as printed in the warrant with the following changes due to a technological malfunction. Salary pool supplement compensation change to change from $232,966 to $217,966. Line 16, salary pool supplement to be changed from $247,966 to $232,966. Summary, general government to be changed from $27,094,571 to $27,079,572, and total budget to be changed from $72,805,966 to $72,790,966 totally. $64,899,774, and further that the lines for department salaries and expenses shall be continued a single appropriation for each department, except for line 98, which shall be for purposes of paying assessments to Northeast Metropolitan Regional Vocational High School and Essex North Shore Agricultural and Technical High School.
We have a motion. I understand that there's a presentation along with the motion. So I'll call on Mr. Gilberto, who would like a 15-minute leave of the meeting for the purposes of the presentation. Leave of the meeting needs to be voted on. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Mr. Gilberto, you have 15 minutes. Well, that's...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We do have the customary presentation on the fiscal year operating budget. Those of you who have been following selected meetings, this was made at the budget hearing earlier in May. The document remains unchanged. I'll go through the slide here quickly.
Can everybody hear me? Can everybody see the slides?
Okay.
So just a quick review of the fiscal year 2019 budget goals, continuing conservative revenue assumptions in our budget, maintaining our critical reserves, maintaining an affordable health plan, continuing to develop alternate revenue sources, and continuing to dedicate budget finance to the capital improvement program. And as we've been doing for the past number of years through the financial planning team, continuing our budget collaboration among town hall, leadership, and department and finance committee. The slide shows a breakdown of the revenue as it's applied in the operating budget for next year, 21.136 million dollars going toward our fixed costs, which include debt service, health insurance, assessments for managing our fixed costs. $30.746 million for the school department operating budget, and $16.192 million for general government operations. Fiscal year 2019 school town split. This is basically taking the amount available after we take the cost out of the revenue plan and allocating it between school operations and our government operations. This slide shows a description of our revenue plan and it's presented in a different format. The finance committee reports, so I'm not going to go through it in detail, but the intention is to show that we've been able to achieve a balanced bottom line budget at the time of the warrant was presented to our. Just a quick note about some revenue adjustments that were identified based on the trends in our experience over the past couple of years. An increase in motor vehicle excise revenues, an increase in penalties and interest charged by the town, an increase in department revenue of about $10,000, an increase in licenses and permits of about $55,000, the use of investment income in the amount of $250,000, our debt capital stabilization alliance of about $148,000, and then indirect costs increased by about $13,000 on the budget. These are some of the key expenditure drivers when you look at the budget compared to last year's budget. $250,000+ increase in health insurance. This is a graph for the length of the sanitation budget. The regional school assessment went up $69,000. Our county retirement assessment, one of those fixed costs, went up $135,000. The snow and ice deficit at the time of the budget hearing was $39,000, now $43,000, as was indicated on the second slide of the warrant article 2, and then an increase in Medicare expenses as well. This slide just shows our current cash reserves as were available as of the budget hearing. Here are the slides also up at the beginning of the town meeting. These are the recommended budgets, again, 21.1 did have a technological error where the amount of funds is essentially double counted, which we were rectified by reducing that appropriation by the amount referenced in the motion. The rest of the printed warrant, other than those changes, remains the same. That bottom line number that you saw on the first slide reflects not only these expenses, but the expenses associated with the enterprise funds built in parks and recreation as well. And that concludes my presentation.
And then you knew you spies. Good job. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Schultz.
The Board of Selectmen recommends 5-0.
Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Silver.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Does the School Committee wish to make a recommendation? Further discussion. Up the bat. Okay, we have amendment sections 36 and 37, and it eliminates salaries and expenses, 36 and 37. I think that means the line items 36 and 37. Mr. Gilbert.
Ms. Margaret, the intention to eliminate the salary and expense line items for the police department budget. The entire budget, the police department line 36 and 37. Every meeting of the police officer.
Please go to the microphone, if you could, please. Dispatch position? That's what you intend to eliminate. If it's only the dispatch, that motion zeroes those line items in their entirety. If that's what you want in the motion, then you'd want to submit it differently.
Submit the motion as please.
Okay. Mr. Schultz.
The current motion on the floor is to eliminate all the police salary and expenses. We'll have no police in the town of Westlake. I believe that's probably an error. We'll move to vote.
Mr. Gilberto.
I'd ask an opportunity
for the Board of Selectmen
to make a recommendation for the Finance Committee.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation on the amendment? The motion is to delete line 36 and 37, page 23 of the warrant.
Thank you.
Yes, the entire Board of Selectmen votes against the motion.
Board of Selectmen
recommend against the motion.
The Board of Selectmen recommend against. Ms. Hurley.
The Finance Committee unanimously votes in opposition to this amendment.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor to amend Article 14 as presented to eliminate line 36 and 37 on page 23, which is salaries and expenses for the police department. On the motion to delete. Anyone seeking recognition? No further discussion on the motion to delete the police department. Salaries and expenses. All those in favor, please say aye. Opposed?
No.
So the motion failed. We're back to Article 14. Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just as a clarification, obviously, some people have been paying attention to budget here. Budget discussions. We're looking to go to civilian dispatch probably in the third quarter, fourth quarter of the upcoming fiscal year. I think it's $52,000 $54,000 in the budget to move to that later on in the fiscal year. But I don't think anybody's going to eliminate that. Mr. Moderator, I move to amend Article 14, fiscal 2019 operating budget. By amending public safety administration line 34 salaries from $30,000 to zero. Police department line 36 salaries from $3,725,785 to $3,715,785. And of the total public safety administration, police department, general government, and total budget appropriations reflect the changes.
On the motion, does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Gilberto, you have a presentation. 5 minutes or less?
Mr. Moderator, I don't believe it will be 5 minutes, unless I believe it will be 10 minutes to address the motion.
Well, you only used five before. What if we give him 15-minute leave of the meeting in case he goes a little over the 10? All those in favor, leave the meeting for 15 minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion carries. This is a presentation on, this is related to this motion on the floor, right, Mr. Gilberto?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Mr. Moderator, Mr. Tommy, thank you very much. We prepared a presentation and was reviewed during the fiscal year 2019 budget process with the Board of Selectmen, during the budget formulation process that relates to public safety administration. The slides are outside here, I'll set them to the slideshow and I'll go through those slides. So just a little bit of background relative to the town's charter, which creates four administrative divisions for the functions of town government: Division of Finance, Division of Public Works, Division of Public Safety, and then Division of Public Service. Under the charter, the Board of Selectmen designates those divisions to be headed by a director, or those in any to be headed by the town administrator or by a government composed of members who serve on compensation. In the event that the town administrator is appointed, the director of any of those divisions should come and be appointed. He shall do so without any additional salary. Another charter of public safety, the administrative responsibility for the protection of persons and property, including the functions of police, fire, emergency management, public health, sealing and waste measures, health and safety inspection, and any other set of public safety services, is designated under the Division of Public Safety. So just a little bit of a note about why structure for creating a public safety administration, public safety director. Why we proposed this, it was proposed earlier in the fiscal year and implemented on February 13th of 2018 for the balance of this fiscal year, which we are in now, and ends on June 30th, 2018. We foresee a growth on public safety needs Pacific, some of it associated with population growth and demographic change, and also the impact from commercial growth that involve ability to generate or to stabilize our tax base. We experienced, as you know, as I referenced earlier, transition to multiple fire power positions, as well as inspection service departments, and in addition to that, we've seen increasing expectations based on our emergency management resources over the past 10 years. We're also looking for sustainability in our fire department staffing approach, which right now relies on all that to provide the first alarm response. For civilian dispatch, which I think was the subject of the motion earlier, we have the potential to consolidate our dispatch as a civilian dispatch, which would free up existing police and fire personnel to address locally needs in town. The idea behind that is to free up existing personnel to be able to respond in the community, not to eliminate positions. The Board of Selectmen was previously provided the town administrator feedback that he delegated his work. All of the above items are anticipated to develop in addition time required to manage critical departments, and the implementation of a public safety director is intended to address this need by making a proven public safety manager available to these departments on a day-to-day basis. To clarify this representation's previous public discussion, no employee involved in this restructuring has indicated that they were leaving employment of the town if they did not receive an increase in compensation. This is a slide that represents the organizational chart for the town of North Reading, and you see the top union voters, the five elected boards or individuals here in town. There's a variety of appointed boards that you see in the kind of angle there as well. And then the position town administrator with the four administrative divisions that I referenced earlier. You see a breakdown of those divisions. This shows the present staffing of the administrative division without the position of the public safety director. We have 14 departments that report directly to the position of town administrator, starting with police, fire, emergency management, building, health, public works, which is already consolidating the division of the town charter with the five divisions you see below it. Finance, which is also consolidating the division of the town charter. Human resources, which has recently added department over the past 2 years, town clerk, public library, parks and recreation, health affairs, veterans, and youth. This shows the table of organization with the public safety director. This is going from 14 park managers going directly to 10 park managers, with the five on the far left, police, fire, emergency management, building, health, reporting through public safety director. The public safety table of organization, again, the town administrator will see the public safety director overseeing those five divisions that I mentioned earlier. This slide shows the staffing in the department. If you read through the warrant, you see the staffing level that's been in there on an annual basis is in there in this year, so I'm not going to go into quantum on that. The goals of the public safety director is to implement consistency policies among public safety departments, practical. Create a unified overall public safety command structure that is lined up with the charter, as I mentioned earlier. To plan for large public safety service structure, which I think is probably the most important reason for proposing this. Additional administrative support for those departments that have been in transition over the past few months. Support and improving the existing emergency management structure that we have in place. And to provide a fresh perspective with an opportunity for innovation by public safety officials who challenge questions as well. To the issue of dispatching which came up, our current model is a split model overseen by the police chief and the fire chief in each department. The uniform police official answers the 911 call, usually as a supervisor, not always. The uniform firefighter conducting triage, EMD, and dispatching apparatus. The potential that we foresee will be available to us as is called for the fiscal year 2019 budget. Public safety director will receive a standalone dispatch center, and it will be able to stand alone in the position where at some point it continues as well. Civilian and non-sworn, non-uniform personnel will be in line with one dispatch and EMD. It will allow a police official, that I mentioned on the left side, to be back on board supervising, and then make a firefighter available to respond to all right now. One firefighter will be on duty at 5, which requires the DIA desk to maintain presence at the station. Those who were called alarm, we evaluated a series of implementation options before we landed at the recommendations for you today. The first was a
full-time standalone director of public safety, including similar to director of public works in the position that is right now. We estimate the cost to be between $125,000 and $175,000 plus the cost of benefits. We felt that that was not something we requested at the time. We looked at a client position, which is similar to our finance director, who's also the town accountant. It was the recommended course of action, chief of police serving capacity, public safety director responsibilities, to be compensated $30,000, and to include the police department overtime on for administrative purposes, if necessary, in the amount of $10,000. We also looked at a part-time standalone position, but we determined that it was likely to be less costly, but it was also unlikely to be as effective, not having a full-time person present, able to dedicate the hours required at any time. And then we looked at contracted services to see if that was an option. We felt that the position had responsibilities of the level of the required employee and the cost would likely exceed $30,000 to have that full-time presence here. A progress update. We guided the hiring and promotional processes in fire within the position of public safety. We've completed the hiring of the building inspector, who met earlier. The budget process, there was a review of fiscal year 18 and 19 budgets, recommendations, and adjustments were made, which were approved by the selectmen in early May and forwarded in March. We've been working to streamline processes and procedures amongst all the public safety departments. There has been an ongoing review by the director of public safety of current practices and procedures for creating inefficiencies. We're looking closely at software, new software for permanent and health, fire, and building. There was a recommendation to install a digital headquarters in the fire department, which is similar to the police digital headquarters in the police department. And finally, we provided an opportunity for my position to provide additional time dedicated to non-public safety conditions. Specific challenges that remain and need to be addressed, increasing fire department full-time costs, adjusting fire department structure to address today's call volume and medical expectation, adjusting fire department structure to reflect the availability of personnel, responding to and planning for additional growth, whether it be subdivisions or growth that's been moved ahead and multiple homes, and responding to a changing demographic that we've discussed at great length over the past few years, with senior citizens becoming a larger portion of the population and in general requiring and potential requiring additional call response and potential contributing to an increase in costs. So with that, that concludes the presentation that I had for this evening. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you.
Nine minutes, 30 seconds. Nice job. Mr. O'Leary, would you like to speak to the motion?
Administration, and the administration of the department as well. He's doing a fantastic job as a great public servant. I appreciate all his efforts as his chief. Just I disagree, strongly disagree with him for this position. So, as I said, I think this is somewhat of an abdication of responsibility. I think we obviously have some challenges in front of us. So the biggest challenges that we have determined at this particular point in time happens to set up pretty much on fire. But we have other challenges, as I pointed out. I don't think this is necessary at all. We have the way that the charter is established, the way that the roles and responsibilities are, and I think what needs to be done should be handled by the administration, town administrator, finance director, finance department, and the board as a whole from a policy center standpoint. I don't think we need to advocate this and put another layer of senior management in between. As far as the methodology goes along, the way that it was done and the timing of it, I didn't agree with. First of all, it should come before this body, the legislative body, if we're going to be fulfilling it, putting in a new position. Well, the charter calls for it, it's never been funded previously. And it was done mid-year with appropriations that were already in the salary pool and with no real public discussion or contemplation by the legislative body at this time. So now's the night. So this is what you're going to have to say. I've been involved for a number of years. First got elected in 1973. I've never seen a position created in the town of North Reading that's been eliminated. All these years, create a new position, the expectation that it's going to sustain itself and going to stay. Again, it comes down to the need and the responsibilities and who should be assuming those responsibilities. I'm concerned about the salary and the stipend associated with it. And again, this is where I don't want it to get personal, but I can't help but mention, you know, where are we at in relation to salary levels for certain positions. Our police chief's salary now is very competitive with area departments, and if we're going to add a $30,000 stipend to it, we're talking in excess of $200,000 a year for one position. I cannot in good conscience stand here and tell you as taxpayers that any one position in this community is worth $205,000 based upon population and needs and size of the department. I've done an analysis of all the area departments, size, and all the rest. I won't get into all, but it's, you know, we're small to medium-sized department. All the surrounding communities, except for the city of Woburn, all surrounding communities already have civilian dispatch incorporated in the police department and in their local government. So this is a new responsibility we're looking at here. It's already included all the other communities. The only community in the whole area that has a public safety director is the city of Haverhill. City of Haverhill, 62,000 people. Their public safety director's salary is $190,000, including the responsibilities, which is a $30,000 to $35,000 additional bump in pay. So if you're going to compare and contrast the position, the need for it, the cost of it, I can't stand here in front of you and honestly justify it. Now, there's no doubt that in a short period of time, and if it continues on, if you desire to retain the position, the Chief Murphy will do a terrific job, and there will be some efficiencies realized, and there will be savings made. You know, but to me, those with the ability to do that already should lie with the people that we have here right now. I don't believe you need to put another layer of senior management between the administration and the department. We have hired a new building inspector, we've hired a new health inspector, we've hired a DPW director because of public safety. But these people that we've hired have a long number of years of experience. They're well-experienced individuals. We're hiring, we just hired, we have a provisional fire chief here. Give him a chance to do his job. Let him recognize, and again, come up through the department. And I think even the union here recognizes that there are changes and efficiencies that can be had. Make them part of the solution. But for us to stand here and start implementing things, you know, having a public safety director shield the administration, I think is wrong. You know, we have some differences in
opinion. Mr. O'Leary, can we wrap it up?
Sure. Right. Very strong differences of opinion with the union as to how things operate. But the place for that to take place, the debate should be the department. And to me, I don't think it's necessary. And Mr. Moderator, I'll ask to leave the meeting for an additional 3 minutes so I can complete my time.
Please go there to ask for an additional leave of the meeting for 3 minutes. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Go there in 3 more minutes.
Thank you. And again, we're talking about the cost of this. So if you decide we're going to do it, the sustainability of this, you know, is it going to become a freestanding position? Not today. You know, and for today, for an individual that has this additional $30,000 stipend a year, what that means for someone who goes to full retirement is an additional $21,000 to $24,000 a year in retirement benefits for one individual. To me, we need to delegate, as we've been somewhat constructively critical with the town administrator to do things, but I believe that we have the people in place now that can handle it. I believe with the will of the board to support the new chief, I think that change can be implemented, and I think with a handout, a reach out to the union to work with us to effectuate the necessary changes, I think we can be achieved. And if not, we're still going to have arbitration and grievances that will be handled. Those are not going to go away. So it's up to you people whether you think it's necessary. It's up to you whether you want to support it. I cannot put conscience stand in front of you today and say I believe it's necessary. Thank you very much.
Mr. Schultz.
I do disagree with my colleague respectfully on this issue. We're a growing town. We have 450 homes being built at Pulte Homes right now. That's going to require a lot of inspections, a lot of Board of Health visits. We have an opiate problem that needs more help. It's not working right now what we're doing. We have a gentleman in Chief Murphy that can fight those issues. It is a little bit misleading to say this is a $200,000 position. It's not. $30,000. In the few months, Chief Murphy has already been handling his position. He has found inefficiencies that have paid for that salary many times over. To me, this is a no-brainer. Our town is growing. We are not the same one-stoplight town that we were 40 years ago. We have an increase in population. We have an increase in services. We don't want it. It's a $30,000 stipend, and it's going to save us so much money in cost coming back. This is a cost-saving measure. It's not a cost outlay. And I do wish people would think of that when they're going to this tonight.
Ms. Manupello.
Thank you, Ms. Moderator. When we discussed this at our select meetings, a few meetings actually that we publicly have discussed, I advocated for a full-time standalone public safety director. It is time we need, because we are not creating a new position. This was already a position created in the charter that was simply filled. What was most compelling to me during the time that we publicly discussed this were two things. First, our town administrator coming to us explaining the need for this position. And second, the department head, which you just heard my colleague explain, there are a number of turnover, a number of changes. We lost long-term serving department heads and have new department heads. And what was compelling to me during our budget hearings was a number of these departments coming forward saying how beneficial it was to have the assistance of the public safety director. There are additional duties that are assumed by this individual, so he should be paid. I think the notion that municipal employees should have a lower salary is a bit antiquated. I don't think that's fair. I can pick out several people who I would say, if we had the, who weren't trying to budget, should probably get a larger salary than what we're currently paying. But in this case, in particular, the public safety director, this is a person who, it is personal. This is a person whose job requires him to put his life online. So we should acknowledge that, and we should give a stipend for that, and over and above what he's currently earning. I wasn't here like some of my colleagues when he was originally hired, so I had no idea where he fell on the pay scale start to finish. But we also do have pay scales in the town that most of our employees are fit into. So however he ended up with the salary, my colleagues who were here at the time would be able to speak to that. But we have a new interim fire chief, you just heard. We have a new interim building inspector.
We just waded through difficulty with the DPW, not with the other public safety director. That was a difficult moment in our history. So it's time for this type of a position. We all know the public safety issues that are facing us, and we have one individual that's managing our emergency management. It's a great time to implement this position, and I ask you to vote against the amendment to eliminate this. Give this individual the chance to continue the good work that he's doing, identifying inefficiencies and potential vulnerabilities that we need to address as a town. Thank you.
Ms. Stillwell.
At Gilmore 21 was the first service. I just have a question. I'm getting mixed emotions here. A, our police chief didn't have enough work to do before, so we're giving him more work. And B, you just hired all these qualified professionals to do their job. Now you're going to come and say, well, I'm going to go oversee. I'm just confused. Why are we paying this money?
To respond to Ms. Fillmore, Mr. Gilbert.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I appreciate the question. Certainly, I guess I won't speak directly to the police chief's work, but I'm sure that his day is filled with a dream and then some. And I know that he has, like all of our department heads, he's required to try and prioritize his workload on any given day. We didn't feel that this was going to have zero impact on his work day, and that's why we made a recommendation for $10,000 line for administrative overtime. And that was to address just the instance that you described, where something comes up that requires attention at the chief's level, he may not be able to provide that attention. We felt that in good conscience having a conversation here, that those instances could come up and we needed to provide a fallback for the department as a whole. I don't think it's a reflection of the police chief not having enough work to do. Again, I know the work on his emphasis. I also wanted to take an opportunity just to address a couple of things that were brought up earlier, some questions that have been posed. The first is the timing of this, why did it come up in the middle of this year? Unfortunately, the retirements that we talked about, the transition in those departments, they all took place between town meetings. They happened after the October town meeting and before this June town meeting. We had to make a determination as to the best course of action to get through the end of the fiscal year, and this was a course of action that I recommended to the selectmen that they approved on February 12th. And then the second thing is, just with regard to the timing again, one of the items I mentioned in the bullet on the previous presentation relative to overtime costs, including this fiscal year over the past 5 years, and three of these years are overtime expenses in the fire department have exceeded available funds. And that's something that's a concern for me. It's something that I think that we need to be prepared to address so we're ensuring we're operating a sustainable department. And my feeling was that that was something that we needed to address right away because of the overdue forecasting in this particular fiscal year. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Moderator, Sean Green, 7 days Road. Can I just speak about this notion of the following reasons? Well, obviously, the forethought was not very thought long enough for why they put the particular position in the job. But just because the position hasn't been filled for some years isn't a good reason not to fill the town. Obviously, the majority of the board feels as though it should be filled. The town administrator's report that I just read behind this position was not something that was obviously thought of before. It was long, thought of, well considered before we thought about the need or this position to be filled at this present time. In addition thereto, the person chose to fill the position. My day-to-day work is usually against police officers. And I can tell you, the years that Chief Burton has been the chief for the town and out director, he has raised the professionalism of his department tenfold without question. And that's across the state. Those days, we fought battling against police officers. And I can tell you, I put his men up against any other department, any municipal department, any state agency. That's the effort that he did when he came on as chief of the Northridge Police Department. He's a man who has the knowledge base, the integrity, and the professionalism. Now is the time. This, you can't consider this as a $205,000 salary for one position. It's two positions. It takes the chief of police in Northridge, it also becomes a public safety director. Public safety director, that now is the opportune time to do this. Why? We have an active fire chief. We have new department heads. Who's the steady force? It's Chief Murphy. The board has told the town administrator, you should delegate. I think he's chosen the right position to fill and the right person to put in that position. I think we as the town of Northridge get a bargain. It's costing $30,000 on the cycle, an additional $10,000 in the salary pool, overtime pool for the police department. The time is now, we're getting it out of bargain, we have the best person possible. I'm voting against this motion, and I wish the majority of this body here does the same. Thank you.
Sir, are you seeking recognition? No. Mr. Callahan.
I'm opposed to this amendment as well. I think the town has got a unique opportunity to do something different. The proposal of having a public safety director, even if other towns aren't doing it, it's not an excuse not to do it. We don't need to follow everybody, we need leaders. We've got good people here, we've got a good chief, we've got a good town administrator who has too many reports. He can't be efficient with that number of people reporting to him. Breaking this up so that there are more efficiencies in the way the town is managed, some new thoughts that go into what we're doing, makes all the sense in the world. $30,000 is a small price. If we were able to hire somebody, as you heard earlier, it would be a lot more expensive. And I think that we probably should have somebody, and should have somebody in that position. The town is growing, there's more housing in the town, opioid problems, it's very, very serious. We need to continue to pay attention to it. We need to have a structure in place that supports the town administrator, that supports the mission of the town. I think this is worthwhile. We will learn from it. 2 or 3 years from now, we can reevaluate it, but I think we need to give it a shot and to support the town administrator in his.
Mr. Prisco, and while you're up, Mr. Prisco, the Board of Selection has a recommendation on an amendment?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay.
And I'm going to be brief as I can. We did spend many time, many hours, and many meetings on this discussion, and I just want to touch on a couple things that you heard today. You, the first one you talked about was just fire, and this isn't just about fire, even though we have a significant trend in our fight economy. That is the old time. You've heard the town administrator say, the last 5 years, at least 3 out of the last 5 years, we have overages. Today, right now, as we see here, we are close to running out of money. We have a new provisional fire chief. So the concept here is try something new. Doesn't mean it has to be forever. But I think we're in the process of transition. We have provisional now. We're going through the process of permanent. We give this a year or two. We make sure we have the right supervision in there. We have to manage these trends. They are not getting better, they're getting worse. We don't have the money. We still don't have the economic development that they're looking for, but we're getting there. And there's going to be a lot of work for the police in the fight economy. We have a lot of people moving in town, and the fight economy needs a lot of upgrades, a lot of structural changes need to be put in place for them to be effective and keep public safety. But you can't do that in a department that has changed. We've gone through. This is our second, I believe our second chief now in 8 years. So in your terms of delivery to all these grievances now that are coming in, you know, change is hard. We shouldn't take it personally, but look at the trends. And if you don't address these trends with the expertise, you know, we keep hearing this delivery talk about town administrator should do his job. The town administrator falls in his responsibility. We know public safety expertise is something that a town administrator has the highest qualifications in. We should have the right to protect our community in place. Again, the $30,000 to give it a year or two. Let's make sure we can take control of these trends. We put the right infrastructure in place. And then probably a couple of town meetings now, maybe there is no need for a director of public safety. But for us, if it's not to shoot down without even giving me a chance, they can make a great mistake. Look at the numbers tell a story. And if you don't really, why did it go down? We're going to be back here asking for more money in October to fund this current year's operating budget. That's all I have to say.
Ms. Castro. There's a microphone right in front of you there. You can swing it out to the aisle a little bit. A little closer to the mic, please.
Deanne Pastor, Mount Broadway. I remember not too long ago when there was other issues dealing with the town of Casey, when we asked for Chief Murphy to set up an advisory leadership in constancy. If someone could just address that in the exemplary job he did, in the efficiencies that he presented, I think it serves as a best practice of his potential and the opportunity that having someone in this company.
To Ms. Castro's point, Mr. Schultz? To Ms. Castro's point?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I'll do my best to answer that as an individual who probably won't have the most associated with Chief Murphy. I know he'll be speaking his time serving as acting county administrator after the departure of former county administrator Greg Gallagher on his fire time, beginning my service in Maryland. 2014. Chief Murphy served as the acting county commissioner during that period of time. He served that effort to lead the departments during that period of time to make sure that they were working to prepare me on an incoming basis to be familiar with their operations and that I have every single department of course my transition prior to the first year. All the conversations facilitated by Chief Murphy. There were a couple of issues that were unresolved after the departure of the previous town administrator, just because of timing and workload that I know he served to resolve as well, because I saw the outcome. Also, not insignificantly, he served in that capacity without requesting any compensation. He currently serves as the interim town administrator in any one time environment, not available at my request, that's without compensation. So that's the best response I could give. I'm sure another member of the board was here at the time to speak to that answer, and I think that's a very accurate summary.
Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. First of all, my experience having been on the board, Chief Murphy, and the DA have always done a fine job and have been progressive in trying to get things done properly and effectively. In this case, I happen to agree with the amendment that was before us for a variety of reasons. There are different ways that that is accomplished. We had what they call the capital improvement plan, giving that type of structure with internal personnel can lead to the same results that we're seeing as the chief is doing right now. It's just a matter of delegating that responsibility and not necessarily always having to be assigned. The other argument is that this is only a temporary position. There's no such thing as a temporary position in the town government. What will happen is, in 2 years, we're going to say it's done so well that we're going to continue doing this, and that'll be another $125,000 to $135,000 for that position. Now, going ahead for a few years, maybe that position will be necessary. And that is not such a bad thing as the town grows. But right now, we can still to the TA. Everybody who works in the TA, and he's going to be the leader on this position. And he's very able, very talented in that regard. The expertise comes from the people that is going to hire. So I want to understand that it's very important that these issues need to be addressed. It doesn't need to be well costly and necessary. I'm saying this is $135,000. This is a bargain. But you don't really need to hire that position to the cost of $30,000 because you have to put yourself right in the office right where you're going to need to. So in that sense, I want to call you as a witness. I hope that this body will work this way. Thank you.
Ms. Fillmore.
Just to reiterate, I'm confused. I mean, $30,000 for the chief to pick up more work, which now means we're going to have somebody pick up more hours to cover what the chief can't cover. Now we're talking about $10,000 in overtime for the police department. And you just hired a brand new fire chief, Department of Public Works, and what you're saying is they're not qualified because you have to have somebody older than the dates. That's all.
Mr. Schultz or Mr. Gilbert? Mr. Gilbert.
So I have a question, and I guess I would take the opportunity to invite the elected departments to speak to the benefit that they see and ask the fire chief to talk. That's okay.
Chief Stats.
Thank you for this opportunity. Clearly,
a little closer. Hold on.
Clearly, the public safety director is a slightly controversial and divisive topic, and I can only speak to my personal experience. Been a valuable resource to me personally in navigating the change from a line officer to the back office, which is pretty significant. So in the questions that I asked and in some of the guidance that I've received, they're excellent. I can't speak enough about it. So to me personally, it's been a tremendous benefit. I'm sure the chief's workload has increased significantly because of some of the questions that I asked, and I'm sure the other department heads as well. So, I just wanted to take the opportunity to say that. Thank you for your opinion regarding qualifications. I don't feel like I've been undermined in any sort of way as far as my authority or my position. So, thank you.
No, you.
Joe Foley, 25 Valley Road. First off, I want to just say one thing about Mr. Yule. I found that the chief and the town administrator are doing better than fine. I think they're doing an exceptional job. Almost out of that. We hired the town administrator 4 years now, and we put our faith and effort into him that he was going to take the town in the direction that he needed because we had some issues prior to that. I commend him for taking 4 years to sit back and run those places to figure out what needed to be done. And anytime you have a situation through attrition or time and stuff like that, that gives you the opportunity to reload. That gives you the opportunity without affecting the current status quo, the current organization greatly. And I think we're between you right now with Tom, which we're going to put our faith in him right now. He's doing the right thing. And putting an organization together that is going to benefit him, benefit his town, benefit the residents. I have full faith in the town administrator that what he's putting forth for our civil tonight is the best interest of the town. That being said, the other thing is you have to look at it this way. It's not a new position. It's something that's been there for years. It's a separate line for $30,000. It's automatic for this deal. Every year, it's a separate line. At any time you feel it's not working, you just don't hold it in. I feel we should give it an opportunity to work. Let the time administrator have this, see how it goes for a year or two. If it doesn't work, you put it down there. But then again, I'm not saying about my personal opinion about the chief. I think he's all what a great job he's doing, and I don't think much needs to say about that. Thank you.
Sir.
Thank you. John Rogers, 39 Tower Hill Road. I just want to pick up on what Ms. Jasper said about best practices and what Mr. Keller was saying about the org chart itself. But up there, I, as a supervisor at work myself, I was rather surprised by the number of direct reports that Mr. Gilberto has now, 14, I think it was. And I'm just wondering, in terms of best practices, even if other towns don't have a public safety director, is that normal for a town administrator to have that many direct reports? If not, how have they been dealing with that?
Mr. Gilberto, for the question.
Thank you. So I can just speak to my first experience and also my conversation with my colleagues as well. And you will find that there is a range of communities. Communities that are smaller than they are, you find that there may be even more direct reports. And it makes the management, I'll put the word in quotes, a lot less structured than one might want to be, because in the end, the capacity to be able to manage effectively is not as strong. We have a large number of direct reports. Communities that are much smaller than ours, you might see that there's a delineation that is only four or five people reporting directly to the town manager or town administrator, depending on the type of the community. And structure, I think, similar is just like south of town Reading, where there's a division of report out through division directors, which provides multiple departments, so there's that mayor in place. And I think that my analysis, we have fallen in the middle, but I think the development that's on the horizon and the need for action we're taking really to ensure the sustainability of what we're delivering to you today is a disruption. That's why I recommended it to the select. Mr. Moderator, I would ask if it would be possible to ask other directors to as well. He's another department that is being supervised by the
other department heads?
Yes. It would be the health director and the building inspector.
If they're seeking recognition, yep. Board of Health.
Bob Bracey, Director of Public Health. Let me just give a little background on the Board of Health. Under Mass General Law, Chapter 111, Section 30, I, as the health agent for the town of Oakland, and I'm appointed by the Board of Health members who are appointed by the town administrator. Under that same Mass General Law, under Chapter 111, the Board of Health makes reasonable rules and regulations. And with that, the Board of Health meets once a month. So as the health agent, I get my guidance from the Board of Health when we meet once a month. When the Public Service Director came in, we got that guidance almost daily, which was, you know, something that I found in favor for and the Board of Health members, because they couldn't be on a daily basis because they're full-time employees themselves. I can say this with the Public Service Director. He's assisted the Board of Health Department staff, myself, the administrative assistant, in streamlining administrative processes, with the purchase orders, enforcement processes, so we didn't have to go through a government page, no pun intended, but Chief Murphy, with his background, has been able to help us streamline some of those issues. He's mediated administrative enforcement issues with us, policies and procedures. I know that we have met together as a public service group, and we've started to work more consistently and more collaboratively together. I have my licenses. My reputation speaks for itself in the job that I do. The benefit that Chief Murphy, the Public Service Director, brings to us is he brings us that daily guidance to help us. And so with that, I know I've spoken to the Board of Health members, myself and the board. We welcome that guidance on a daily basis. Thank you.
Up in the back. Catherine? We have a move to the question. All those in favor of moving to the, this is on the amendment. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Motion carries. I would still like to get the recommendation from the Board of Selectmen. If I may, Mr. Schultz.
The Board of Selectmen votes 4-1 in opposition to the amendment.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Hurlbut.
Finance Committee is unanimously opposed to the amendment.
Point of order, Mr. Moderator. Check for items 67 Barbers Road. I request to be involved in this vote. We have not hit ballot.
I need 25 people to stand for a paper ballot. Could my tellers, could the tellers please count their sections? I got my 25. All right, we will vote to a paper ballot on this. Ms. Capitola. Yes, you need this one. Unless I'm incorrect, Mr. Gilberto, or Mr. Klein, Town Council.
Darren Klein, through the moderator. The motion is to simply eliminate the funding of line 36 and reduce the funding of 34 and reduce the funding in line 36 by 10,000. Town meeting doesn't have the authority to determine positions and organizations.
Ma'am, I'm sorry, Mr. Delaney, another question?
So, if the motion...
Microphone up, please.
The motion prevails, the town administrator could still find funding for this position elsewhere in the budget, is that correct?
Mr. Klein.
Darren Klein, again, with the moderator. That is potentially true. It would have to be an appropriate expenditure from another line item, which would ultimately be determined by the board or department head that's in charge of that line item.
Thank you.
Ma'am.
Minnesota Health is 28 on the street. I just want to be, make sure I'm understanding 100%. This is our, my first time meeting, and I don't want to think I'm understanding it one way and then not vote the way that I want to. My understanding is for the ballot, does that mean we get to go to ballot next time, or is that the decision still being?
No, we're doing a paper ballot tonight.
So you do it tonight?
We're doing a paper ballot tonight. The town clerk will be up here in a few minutes to give you the instructions. They're putting it all together. We will do a paper ballot tonight, and then we will count the ballot and announce the results.
Okay.
Okay.
Just to be clear, so I do it appropriately.
So again, I read the motion again. If you want to fund the position, you vote no. If you don't want to fund it, you vote yes.
And would I be able to ask one question that I had regarding that?
Yes, ma'am.
My other question is how do we know, or has it been thought put into this yet, as to making sure that the safety director position is employing from the chief duties and the chief position is employing from the safety director?
Oh, I'm sorry, we're past that point.
Okay.
I can't entertain that question at this time.
Okay.
Please only speak to the paper ballot issue, Mr. Yule.
Yes, to Sean Delaney's question with regard to the line item being taken from another line item. It's my understanding that we are voting not to fund either line item 32 and the 34 and the other overtime item, that no one is allowed to move money around because town meetings said no, not fund, do not fund it.
Mr. Klein answered that question. If you want to speak now, speak to the paper ballot, because I've had a call for a paper ballot. We're going to a paper ballot. 43 people stood up. I needed 25. This is a long process, and I didn't be out last night. So it's a long morning and a long night. Mr. Klein, do you want to clarify?
I'll just restate what I said because I have the warrant in front of me this time. The motion again is to delete the funding that's provided in line 34 of the budget and to reduce the line item 36 by $10,000.
Okay. Now he has to explain the process for paper ballot. So it's not me describing the process. May I introduce Barbara Stafford, town clerk.
Well, I would rather the applause were for some other circumstance, as this is going to be a challenge in this new facility. We have done many paper ballots in the past in the old high school. It was a relatively simple, flowing process. Given the challenges with the sections on the side not having the access from both sides of the aisle, this is going to be somewhat slow, but we're going to take our time so that it's done correctly, and we do have a process in place. Everybody will be given a yes-no ballot. You will tear off whichever portion that you want, and I want to stress again that we're voting on the amendment. So a yes vote would mean you are voting in favor of the amendment, and a no vote would mean you are voting against the amendment. So be sure that you are clear on which half of the ballot you are going to use to put into the receptacle that's marked ballot. We will have another receptacle that's marked discards, and you can put the other half of your ballot in that. If you want to stick it in your pocket, you can do that as well. So we're not going to count the discards, but we will be counting the ballots. At the time, one of my tellers and I will be handing out a ballot to everyone. And at that same time, you will receive a different colored ribbon. a green ribbon. This is to ensure that nobody receives two ballots. There's no duplicate voting. So once you receive your ballot and your ribbon, we're going to take away the aqua ribbon. So if you have received a green ribbon and you come to someone and say, I didn't get a ballot, we're not going to give you another ballot, because we are assuming that if you have a green ribbon and you have relinquished your aqua ribbon, you have a ballot in your possession and you will not get another one. That is to ensure that the counts are accurate and that no one, and to prevent duplicate voting. So given the challenges of this setup, we are going to have, myself and my staff are going to be walking around, going row by row to present to you a ballot and your ballot box. You can just tear it off, put it in the box. You will exchange your ribbon at that time. Are there any questions? Okay, we do ask that you not leave this room until you have balloted. If you have balloted and you want to take a break and leave the assembly, that's fine, as long as you have your green ribbon on. But until that time, I do ask that you stay in your seats and wait until you have balloted, and then you will be responsible to come back in when the balloting is over.
This is not for the warrant article.
This is not Article 14. This is the amendment to Article 14, deleting line 34 for $30,000 and changing the police department line 36 by $10,000. This is voting on the amendment only. After this vote, we would then vote on the main motion, depending on the outcome. If you vote yes, you want to delete the $30,000 from line 34, and you want to delete $10,000 from the police department budget. If you vote no, you agree with Article 14 as presented with no amendments. The Finance Committee was unanimous against the amendment, and the Board of Selectmen is 4-1 against the amendment. Sir, if you could go to the microphone,
please. My name is Russell Moore, 272 Harshman. Mr. Moore, it seems to me that at the beginning, when we started out before you, about an hour ago, someone tried to amend line 36 and 37, and we found it out of order. Is it?
No, sir, I did not. I had a motion. After seeing no further discussion, the original amendment was to zero fund the police department.
I wrote exactly what he said. I move to amend Article 14, Sections 36 and 37, by eliminating salaries and expenses of the permanent warrant. Excuse me. Now, you took it that as the to eliminate all the salaries, which absolutely didn't make any sense. It seems to me that someone, rather than more particularly, should have asked the proposal for the amendment, who do you want to do?
I did, sir.
No, you did not.
I apologize if you didn't see it. I did, sir. Everyone clear on the voting process? First, I'd like to thank Barbara, because because she was prepared. She brought all that stuff with her, as she probably does every time, and I just don't know it. And thank her tellers for their work. So we went to the paper ballot because we had 43 people stand. We had 170 registered voters check into the meeting. We had 164 ballots cast. The votes were yes, 76, no, 88. The amendment fails. We are back to Article 14 with no amendments. So on Article 14, there are no amendments. Is there an amendment? If there are no amendments to Article 14, we will now vote on Article 14 as presented. That's the budget. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of Article 14, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
I'm going to call it again. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion carries. Mr. Delaney.
Moderator, John Delaney, 7th Dix Road. I move for reconsideration of the motion.
You're moving reconsideration on Article 14?
On
the amendment.
It's on the motion presented by this
amendment.
On 14. You can say the article, say it.
There's another motion for Article 14. It would be more appropriate after the second motion for Article 14. Mr. Schultz.
This is the second motion for Article 14, fiscal year 2018 operating budget. I move to raise and appropriate and transfer the sum set forth in the column headed Select and Recommended, line 99, debt service, the amount of $7,891,192, including the transfer of other funds, all as set forth in the budget detail dated June 4, 2018, printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to recommend? Mr. Schultz.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
The Finance Committee, Ms. Hilbert.
Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? This covers the debt service portion of the budget, which requires a two-thirds vote. All those in discussion, Mr. McGrath.
I believe that we're speaking.
Mr. Newberg, please into the microphone so everyone can hear.
Certainly. Can everyone hear me now?
Yes.
For clarification, Mr. McGrath, through you, Mr. Moderator, the question is regarding the list of debt service. There is a school boiler dated June 2011. Is that the one you're asking for? Through you, Mr. Moderator.
Mr. McGrath.
Which one?
It's the first one of the fiscal debt, it's module 3. And then there's module classrooms 10-6, 10-10/06. And then look for the down school world 6-11.
Mr. Gilbert, Mr. Chairman, I'd ask that perhaps somebody from the school committee or the school department may be able to speak specifically to the project in question.
Ms. Slavin.
Okay, Mr. Moderator. I believe the answer to the question is the modulars 3 would be the hood school modulars. The modular classroom 10-06 would be the little elementary school modular. And the school boiler 06/11 would be the little school boiler.
Mr. McGrath.
So just for clarification, there's 2 line items regarding good school modulars, because the 5th one now is the hood and high modulars. Is that the same, or is it more? Fifth item on that list is hood and high modules.
Mr. Collin.
Yes, that's correct. The hood school and the high school modules, which have been demolished, but that is what the 5th line item would be both.
Your old son? Any thoughts?
Mr. Silver.
We're going to need to take a moment to review the debt service schedule for that particular project in order to answer the question.
They need a few minutes to review the debt service schedule. Mr. Gilbert.
Through you, Mr. Moderator, we are attempting to bring up the debt schedule for those projects. That would answer this question, but it is going to take us a few more minutes. Through you, Mr. Moderator.
Do we have any answers?
Liz Ward. Okay. Mr. McGrath, you go to the microphone, please. Question clarification. From Liz Ward.
Through you, Mr. Moderator. Can you please ask your question in regards to modulars? Through you once again.
I was asking which school was begin with on module 3, and it was, we're close to paying for these off because if you look at just the last 3 years, we spent a lot of money on modules, so I'm just getting clarification of what we're spending on. That was.
Sure. So on modules 3, FY19 is the last payment. So this $51,000 that is in the debt service fund for modules 3 is the last final payment for modules 3. We're looking in the annual report for 2005 to see exactly for which school that is for at the time being. And what were your further questions on Hood?
Well, it was the Hood module 3, and then I just finally saw there's a little line item where they said Hood and High modules. I'm assuming it's supposed to be high school. The fifth line item. And then you put in the middle school modules from, I'm guessing, the date and today for the town meeting, October town meeting 2006. I'm asking.
Further discussion. Mrs. Swanley requires 2/3. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Mr. Delaney?
Mr. Moderator, I would move a reconsideration and raise an appropriate portion of Article 14.
What? The rest of the narrative. Just kidding. We have a motion to reconsider the vote on Article 14. A motion to reconsider an article. If. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Yeah. We voted on two motions. Yeah, which unanimous. There's two motions under Article 14. One was the budget. There was an amendment that failed, the first amendment that failed. There was another amendment. We did a paper ballot. That amendment failed. We then voted on Article 14. Then we had a motion two on Article 14 for the debt service. We had a discussion and a delay while we looked up the debt service to answer questions from the audience. I then called for a vote, and it was unanimous. And the clerk has the paperwork. And she just said correct. So, okay. So now, we have another motion on Article 14. We have a motion to reconsider. If you vote yes to reconsider Article 14, it can be brought back up later in the meeting. If you vote no on the motion to reconsider, this article is complete and done for this town meeting. No more motions on it. I apologize. If you vote to reconsider, you could make a motion now, but you can't bring it up later. Only one time. Mr. Klein.
Darren Klein, KB Law, through the moderator. So the motion to reconsider is essentially both main motions that were just passed for Article 14, correct?
Correct. And it's a motion to reconsider Article 14 and its entirety.
So a yes vote would be a vote to reconsider the entire article, both motions. A no vote would be to not reconsider Article 14. It would result in Article 14 being final and not being able to be brought up again.
Everybody clear? All those in favor of reconsideration, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
The motion to reconsider fails. Article 15, Ms. Megan Miller.
Article 15, fiscal year 2019 capital expenditures. Mr. Moderator, I move to appropriate amounts to purchase items of the capital needs as specified in Article 15 as printed in the warrant and recommended by the Capital Improvement Plan Committee. And furthermore, in all instances where bond is listed as the source of funds, said borrowing will be pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 7, Paragraph 1, or any other enabling authority, to authorize the Treasurer with the approval of the Board of Selectmen to borrow said specified sums and issue bonds and notes therefore, and further that any premium received upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, less any such premium applied to the payment of the cost of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of costs approved by this vote in accordance with Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 20, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by a like amount.
We have a motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation to the amended ballot?
Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mr. Kelleher.
The Finance Committee recommends.
The School Committee.
The School Committee recommends.
Further discussion. This also has some components of bonding, so it requires a two-thirds vote. Mrs. Bailey.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Mark's name is Greenwood. I just had a question regarding the town road line item. Is the bill part of Elm Street, or is it being actually able to come to this? That's, I think, bond overdue for some work. And as far back, or said to be able to as far back.
Gilberto, to the question.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. There's been some discussion relative to the condition of the stretch of Elm Street that I think you're referring to between Winter Street and Haverhill Street, if I understand it correctly, up around.
No,
but if it's between Haverhill. Yes, Park and Winter. Yeah, so it's the intersection with the blinking light up to Haverhill Street, correct? Okay, so that area came up in a capital request by the Department of Public Works, I think 4 years ago, for a substantial stormwater improvement that was required prior to being able to be paved. And at that time, the Capital Improvement Planning Committee was unable to recommend the construction that needed to take place for that to occur. I think in the town engineers here, we can certainly attest, we've all seen the condition of the pavement, but the challenge has been the stormwater improvements that would be required to address it. It's something that I anticipate the DPW will be looking at over the course of the next Capital Improvement Planning Committee review round. The request for that, for a project to address that, would be due in October, but it would be subject to funding. So to answer the question, no, it is not something that's identified in the current work plan, only because of the significant stormwater improvements that we believe are required.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 16. Ms. Manny Pelley.
Article 16, rescind authorization to borrow. Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 16 as printed in the warrant.
We have motion to pass over. Recommendation from the selectmen, Ms. Manny Pelley.
Selectmen recommend pass over.
Finance Committee, Ms. Silver.
Finance Committee recommends to pass over.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 17, Ms. Manny Pelley. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Article 17, reappropriate previously approved funding for water distribution and supply infrastructure. Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 17 as printed in the warrant.
Recommendations for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. O'Leary.
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend passing over.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Silva.
Finance Committee also unanimously recommends passing over.
Just by way of further discussion, Mr. O'Leary.
Just by way of explanation, you know, we had appropriated over the last several town meetings significant amounts of money for joining the MWRA. As was pointed out earlier this evening, the Board of Selectmen unanimously signed intermunicipal agreement, both short-term and for a 99-year, subject to special legislation to go with Andover. There's still a window of opportunity for something to go wrong. I mean, again, we hope not. But unless and until the legislation is passed and signed into law by the governor, you know, we do not want to reappropriate the money for any other purpose at this particular time. The next article is also related to that. So we just ask for your indulgence, we'll pass this over. If we don't need it come October, we'll reappropriate it over in the bonding.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 18, Mr. O'Leary.
Mr. Moderator, appropriate funds, Article 18, for water distribution and supply infrastructure. Moderator, I move that the town appropriate the total sum of $3 million for water distribution and supply infrastructure construction and costs related thereto, as specified in Article 18 of the warrant, and as funding, therefore, to authorize the Treasurer, with approval of the Board of Selectmen, to borrow said sum under and pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 44, Section 7 or 8, or any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds and notes of the town, therefore, while the bonds issued hereunder shall be general obligation bonds of the town, it is anticipated that this borrowing shall be repaid from the Water Enterprise Fund. Further, that the Board of Selectmen is authorized to pursue federal, state, or other grant funding, the proceeds of which may be allocated towards said projects. And further, that any premium received by the town upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, unless any such premiums applied to the payment of the cost of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of costs approved by this vote in accordance with Mass General Law, Chapter 44, Section 20, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by a like amount, and further to authorize the Board of Selectmen to take any other action necessary to carry out this project.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation?
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend.
For the Finance Committee.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Further discussion? Mr. O'Leary.
If you just look up behind me here, just a little update. Once again, the Board of Selectmen signed a 99-year intermunicipal agreement with the Andover Board of Selectmen earlier this evening. Congratulations to all of us. State law limits terms on an intermunicipal agreement to 25 years, so that's why we're going for 99. So the agreement is conditional to passage of a bill authorizing the 99-year term. In the interim, town meeting is being asked to authorize $3 million for construction for either Andover or MWRA. We say that because we delayed the Board of Selectmen last fall, enabled ourselves to look at the option for Andover. We had to postpone construction. We were ready to go out for construction in the town of Reading to tie into the MWRA. We put that off for basically a year of construction season. We anticipate that there are increased costs associated with the construction if we have to go to the MWRA. We do not anticipate that it's to the full $3 million extent. The $3 million figure is our best estimate as to what infrastructure needs we will have to appropriate in order to build some treatment plants when we tie into Andover and take all of our water from Andover and some additional upgrades to our own system. So that's where the $3 million comes from. It's important to note that we were the recipient, you probably saw the pictures in the paper, the governor came of a $3 million Mass Works grant, which can be used for water project, potable water. So again, we have to appropriate the money first before we get to spend it. We are able to go with Andover, and we'll have the appropriation in place and move forward with it expeditiously, and also be able to apply the grant money to offset this. So we probably won't need it all, but we still have to appropriate it in order to move forward. So we're asking your indulgence to appropriate the $3 million, and whichever direction we have to go in, we'll have the money to do it. So if Andover, at a future town meeting, we anticipate requesting to rescind the June 17th and October 17th appropriations. That's the construction monies and joining the MWRA. So October, if everything goes through with Andover, we're going to rescind that. And again, if we go MWRA, we anticipate requesting to rescind unused portion of this appropriation. So we're only going to use that portion of what we need to cover the increased construction costs. So we're this close. The board has made a decision. Now it's in the hands of a third party, which is the legislature and the governor. We're going to move forward. If that fails, we're going MWRA, and everything's in place already, including your appropriations. This is just to cover the cost. So we ask your indulgence for a short period more, but we don't want to be talking about this anymore. So we appreciate your support.
Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Mr. Irwin. Question on the construction of either Andover or MWRA. I understand the MWRA, but what costs would we have with Andover? As I recall, it was just a matter of turning on the circuit and allowing more water coming through Andover without any additional cost to the town of North Reading.
It's more than just opening the spigot. We're talking about eventually taking all of our water, 100%. We're currently at about 60%, 100%. So we're going to have to treat the water coming in with chlorination plants at both Central Street and Main Street. So we have to build those plants, and there'll be some other infrastructure costs in order to take the more water from Andover. So there is a cost, far less than MWRA, certainly. And this is the best estimate we have to date, and it's conservative. to effectuate getting 100% of our water from Andover.
Is there a follow-up, Mr. Yule?
Yes.
Mr. Yule.
Yeah, I didn't hear what the cost would be for Andover. Is it a small cost by comparison?
This is a very small cost. We were talking about between buy-in and infrastructure that had to take place in the town of Reading and building a $3 million pump station here. We're talking close to $17, $18 million for MWRA. And with this, we're talking about $3 million with the total cost of tie-in with Andover.
Thank you.
And again, with Andover, we can phase this in. You know, in other words, we're already getting our water. We still have our wells operating. We'll be decommissioning those over time. So Andover actually gives us a little more extended time to phase this whole thing in.
Further discussion. This requires 2/3 vote as it pertains to bonding. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 19, Mr. O'Leary. Oh, Mr. Mysterio.
Yes, Mr. Moderator, I am here this evening. I move to raise and appropriate the sum of $180,000 for the purpose of funding the FY 2019 retirement obligation for town employees as specified in Article 19 as printed in the warrant.
We have a motion, recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Mysterio.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
Finance Committee, Ms. Silva.
Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Further discussion? Mr. Mysterio, any further discussion?
The funds are used to pay retirement obligations for all town employees, which would include the school department, and typically for unused vacation when a retiree retires, and also sick leave buyback.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 20, Mr. Mysterio.
Mr. Moderator, I move to raise and appropriate the sum of $300,000 for the purpose of funding the other post-employment benefits liability trust fund established under Article 36 of the June 3rd, 2013 town meeting as specified in Article 20 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion, recommendations for the Board of Selectmen. Mr. Mysterio.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Silva.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Further discussion, Mr. Mysterio.
A while ago, the Board of Selectmen trying to deal with this whole OPEB issue of, you've heard, 30 million, 40 million, 50 million, it varies, it seems, over time that we owe our retirees to pay for their health insurance, which we pay on an annual basis now. And the objective is to get to a point where we put money away to deal with it. And what is seemed to be affordable to the board was to take all new hires and start to put money in a fund to cover their health insurance when they retire, and continue to pay those retirees out of our annual budgets. And we felt this was an affordable way to deal with the issue, although the laws could be changed. I think right now, towns are obligated to completely fill that fund by, I think it's 2040. And that seems to vary as time goes on, too.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 21, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Fund assessment of field review. I move to transfer from overlay reserve a sum of $40,000 to fund an assessment field review as specified in Article 21.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation, Mr. O'Leary?
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Hogan.
Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Further discussion? Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The state had instituted a new type of software system, so we were interfacing with the state. As a result, the town had to update its software and was required to do a conversion, a software conversion. So to ensure that all property information has been properly converted, we have to do field review. The cost for the field review is going to be about $40,000, and that's why we're asking for the funds.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Article 22, Mr. O'Leary.
Article 22, appropriate money for special counsel legal expenses. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from overlay reserve the sum of $75,000 for negotiation, mediation, and or litigation with PMA Consultants LLC and Doran Whittier Architects concerning the secondary school building project and all costs incidental and related thereto as specified in Article 22 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion, recommendation for the selectmen, Mr. O'Leary.
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Gilbert.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Further discussion, Mr. O'Leary.
As you are probably well aware, for the last several years, we've been involved in litigation over the construction of this facility here. If you recall, we had to go back and get an additional $15 million after cutting close to $5 or $6 million out of the budget in order to complete the project. The board felt it was important to hold the parties accountable for the action or inaction that was taken. And those parties are PMA, which is our project manager, and Doran Whittier, the architect. We have hired counsel, which is Furman, Gregory Deptula. Again, to date, we have spent approximately $587,000, and we have approximately $178,000 remaining of authorized unexpended funds. We have been meeting with counsel on a regular basis. They have started depositions. They've done a lot of discovery. We have expert witness reviews, which is why we've spent what we have. As we've been discussing with counsel, we've been getting advice that the case actually looks very strong and that we've already committed to it, so it would be difficult to back out of this time anyway, but the case looks strong. There have been counterclaims filed, so that we have to defend ourselves against counterclaims from the other parties. We have additional depositions to take place and expert witnesses to review. And this amount will get us through October. You can't anticipate that we will be back in October. And we're doing this piecemeal as we allow ourselves to have enough of a cushion to get us through certain dates and through town meetings. You can anticipate we will be back in October because there will be dates set for actually court appearances. So. We're looking for the additional $75,000 to take us through at least October.
Further discussion? Mr. Harris.
Richard Harris, before we move on to the next questions, we're assuming that people that we hired them to withdraw from us, because they had them and they didn't really find them
They certainly fell short of our expectations, and we believe that it cost us money up front. So the only way that we can hold them accountable is to file suit. Their insurance companies are involved.
Mr. Harris,
we believe we got shortchanged.
We definitely got shortchanged. I can prove that in my house. Anyways, what is it that we're going after? Is it going to cover our expenses once we win? Are we spending $1 million to get back $50 in the network?
No, we anticipate, based upon the advice of council, that we're going to be getting well in excess of what's being expended, and there will be some damages.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Right into the microphone, please.
I know it's difficult to predict. Do you have an approximate cost of what this lawsuit will cost the town?
We have no predictable costs, but I think the best estimate is probably in excess of $1 million for the suit for our side. But again, we're not going to ask for that now. We're going to ask for it as we go, and council will advise us as to what stage he's at and how much he anticipates the costs are going to be to move forward with the case.
Further questions? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Motion carries. Article 23, Mr. Messier.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote pursuant to the provisions of General Laws, Chapter 59, Section 5K, which the town previously accepted under Article 5 of the April 3rd, 2000 annual town meeting, to allow the Board of Selectmen to adjust the exemption authorized by the statute by allowing a maximum reduction of the real property tax bill of up to $750 to be based on up to 100 volunteer service hours in a given tax year as specified in Article 23 as printed in the warrant.
We have a motion and recommendation for the selection. Mr. Messier.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee. So.
Finance Committee recommends.
This is. Discussion, Mr. Messier.
This is a program we set up for seniors that were struggling with their tax bill, and they could. In the past, they, for 94 hours of time spent, they get $500 removed from the tax bill. And this is a proposal to move it so they get $750 off the tax bill for serving in some form in the town for 100 hours, volunteering 100 hours.
Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. First of all, I want to thank the Board of Selectmen for approving this. It's a great program. It's a great improvement. It only increases $7.50 per hour, which is a little range, but it's still a great program for our seniors and helps the town and for those working at the town hall. So thank you. It's an urgent support.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 24. Mr. Messeri. Mr. Messeri, Article 24.
Mr. Moderator. I move to create a special purpose stabilization fund as provided for under MGL Chapter 40, Section 5B for the future payment of the town's health insurance costs as specified in Article 24 of the warrant.
We have a motion and recommendation from the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Messier.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Gilbert.
Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion, Mr. Gilberto.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just a very brief presentation relative to this program. In fiscal year 2018, which began last July 1st, 2017, working with the local health insurance broker, the town transitioned to what's known as a partially self-funded health insurance program called a participating funding arrangement, or PFA. In the program, the town and employees share in the cost of health insurance, jointly purchasing a high deductible or higher deductible plan from a carrier. In this case, it's Blue Cross Blue Shield of Massachusetts. The PFA then reinsures by setting aside town and employee contributions to implement a lower actual deductible plan than what we're buying from Blue Cross Blue Shield. The total cost has been less than purchasing that actual lower deductible cost directly from the carrier. The plan performance in the first year, based on the reports from our consultant, was excellent, which resulted in a surplus in set-aside funds, which we had projected would take place as far back as last year. Establishing this fund would provide a place for the town to transfer the town's portion of those set-aside funds for future health insurance costs. This action, either setting up the account or any future transfers, would not include the employee contribution portion of this, and those who have been present in the employee discussions are familiar with what I'm speaking to, but there is a share of the premium that is paid by employees, and that is accounted for separately and held separately. Probably most importantly, the action tonight is to set up the fund, but not transfer any funds into it this evening. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 25, Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote pursuant to the provisions of General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53E½, as most recently amended, to establish a revolving fund for the payment of inspection services in the development of 102 through 104 Lowell Road, and to amend the General Bylaws, Chapter 66, Finance, Article 1, Revolving Funds, Section 66-1, establishment of revolving accounts by adding said revolving fund to the end of the list as specified in Article 25 in the warrant.
We have the motion, recommendations for the selectmen. Mrs. Masseri.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Hilbert.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion, Mrs. Masseri.
The purpose of this revolving fund is to take the fees for the permitting of the building of the Pulte property, basically, and put that money into a fund to pay for the extra inspectional services that are going to be required of our inspection department.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Article 26, Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote pursuant to the provisions of General Law, Section 44, 53E½, as most recently amended, to establish expenditure limits on revolving funds established by the Code of North Reading General Bylaws, Chapter 66, Finance, Article 1, Revolving Funds, Section 66-1. Establishment of revolving fund accounts to remain applicable from the fiscal year to fiscal year until such time as amended by the town meeting as specified in Article 26 of the warrant.
We have the motion recommendations from the selecting Mrs. Masseri.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Ms. Hilbert.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Further discussion?
think if you look in your warrant, you'll see a list of revolving funds and the amounts limited by those funds. And each year in the past, we've had a motion to approve each of the revolving funds. And now under changes in state law, we're allowed to set it up once and only have to make changes when we want to amend those limits.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 27.
Mr. Moderator, I move to amend the Code of North Reading General Bylaws, Chapter 1, General Provision.
Wrong article.
What?
I think.
Oh. I'm sorry. It was, excuse me.
Mr. Prisco.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Excuse me. I move that the town authorize the Board of Selectmen to petition the General Court for a special act amending the town charter to change the title of Board of Selectmen to Select Board by replacing references to the Board of Selectmen with the Select Board and Selectmen with Select Board Member, replacing references to Selectmen with Select Board Member, providing, however, that the General Court shall be authorized to make ministerial, clerical, editorial changes of form only to said bill unless the Board of Selectmen approves amendments to the bill before enacted by the General Court, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to approve such amendment as are in the public purpose of this petition as specified in Article 27 of the warrant.
We have the motion recommendation from the selection, Mr. Prisco.
Board of Selectmen recommend 3-2.
Finance Committee, Mr. Silver.
There's no action required.
Further discussion, Mr. Prisco.
I'll try to be as brief as I can. The real main purpose of this is we have 351 cities and towns in the Commonwealth. And we only have about 24% women involved in all those committees and boards throughout the whole entire Commonwealth. The fact is, the title is conspicuously inaccurate. But we have an opportunity tonight to make this change to a gender-neutral name that will hopefully encourage more women to run for election. As you can see, we need more people to run. We need more people to get involved in town government. You know, North Reading is a kinder community, welcoming community. I think this is an opportunity for us to make that move. There are dozens and dozens of municipalities all around us making this change right now. Not because it's the PC thing to do. It's because it's the right thing to do. There's nothing negative that's going to come out of this. There's been over 35 cities and towns that have already made this exact change, and I hope you will support this article to make this change. So you'll see three articles. We have to go through this process, and this one is for a charter amendment. And the next one you'll see is the bylaw amendment and the zoning bylaw.
Further discussion? Sir.
John Rogers, 39 Tarver Hill Road, very supportive of the spirit of these amendments. I was wondering if consideration was given to changing the name of town council and why that was rejected as, you know, way for this a few weeks ago to change theirs to town council. It seems a little less cumbersome.
Mr. Klein.
Darren Klein, keep you through the monitor. Town council is typically supposed to be sort of a town version of city council. So it's not defined by law, but most town councils actually are the legislative branch. of that town. They've sort of become known as the city known as the town of X, Y, and Z. And the town council would actually replace town meeting to take it and basically act in a similar role as city council. Now, there's no law saying that, but if you adopted the name town council, it could easily be confused with the, that term, because that is how what most town councils are in Massachusetts.
Man. Nope. Yep.
Alderman Longbobber, 15 Burroughs Road. I'm also very appreciative of this. I think it's long overdue. We need more representation, and women and girls and non-binary people aren't going to feel represented as long as the name stays the way it is. As the mom of a transgender child, I know several people who don't identify as either men or women, and to have this gender-neutral title would mean the world to them, and I think this is very forward-thinking, and I absolutely approve of this. Thank you so much.
Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. On the surface, I really enjoy agreeing with this, but I don't believe that women are intimidated because it says the Board of Selectmen. I think I have too much respect and admiration for women because they can stand up on their own and not be intimidated because of the title. I don't support this because it is PC, plain and simple. There's a tendency for societies to get on the wave and just begin to make changes because it's the thing to do. And I know earlier it was mentioned that North Reading shouldn't do what other towns do, we should do what we should do. And now we have an idea here because of what the town's doing. So we do it because we're North Reading, or we do it because of the other towns doing it. I don't support this simply because of the primary reason that was given by one of the Board of Selectmen on the community connection. He made it a gender issue, and he made it a race issue, and it should not have been done. If it did for the right reasons, it sounds good. But the fundamental thing was, and primary opinion of that selectman was, they were not comfortable with their own skin, so they felt that this is how I'm doing it. I can quote the person, but I'll just leave it to him. Thank you.
Ms. Manupelli.
I'll be brief. There's a Latin phrase, temporis mutandum, where it means time to change. And there's a reason why this was called the Board of Selectmen when we were organized in 1853, because we came away from Reading and developed our own town. We took after their government, and they had a Board of Selectmen at that time. And at that time, as we all know, we didn't even have the right to vote as females. That didn't come in until 1920. So I have read the debate in these forums, and I have read the dialogue, and I can appreciate everybody's opinions, but I don't like to label it as a progressive type of a thing, or a liberal, or women's livers, or a you know, gender issue. What I'd like to do is catch up with the times, and at this point, that's about 100 years ago. And I think you might have caught me labeling the gentleman that served on the board in 1920 as progressive. This was proposed back then, but it isn't the case. And I don't like to get into labels, but I think this is a relatively innocuous warrant article. And it can be as offensive or as innocuous as we want to make it. I'm hoping that the language that this community chooses to refer to this board as inclusive. And that, I think, is the impetus behind this. I appreciate Mr. Crisco for suggesting it, and I appreciate appreciate my colleagues for supporting it. I think we could be agents of change here. I would ask my colleagues that don't support it respectfully to reconsider their vote. And I hope everybody here will vote in support of it. Mr. Yo, you're right. People aren't going to be intimidated by a name. Obviously, I'm standing here, and I'm not a man. And I ran for the Board of Selectmen. But I would like to see us move with the time, move to this century, and catch up with how the times have changed. The other part of that Latin phrase is, and we change with the times. And I would hope that the language that we choose to refer to the board is inclusive. And there's another point that, if I'm just to be very brief, there's another point in terms of what was raised as a cost factor to this, and I'd just like to eliminate that subterfuge, because we did ask about that and what it would cost to make these changes. And most of us that are familiar with basic word processing know it's essentially find, replace key, and you replace the term. And we didn't get a quote on it because, as a matter of course, this is the town clerk does make modifications at the end of the year for town meeting. That's already a budgeted item. So again, this really was a name before women even had the right to vote. And I think it's important, it says something about our community. We be the agent of change and make this change. I think it's important. I think it sends the right message. So I hope you'll reconsider and change your mind about it and vote in favor of the article. Thank you.
Mr. Schultz. Oh, I'm sorry. You've been standing a while. Sorry, Mr. Schultz. And then I'll go to you.
I'll be real brief. When this first came before us, I really didn't have any thoughts on it, to be honest with you, because, you know, as a male, it doesn't really affect me. I never thought about it. And then when I contemplated it further, it does affect half the people in this room, and it doesn't hurt anybody. So the people that are against it, I ask you to come outside of your comfort zones and realize that there are people in this room, meaning the women in this room, that are affected by this. And it's really not that big of a deal if we change the name. The sun's still going to come up tomorrow, and we're going to be more in tune with the times. So I ask people to come out of their comfort zone, and this is a good thing for the town. That's all.
Yes.
Yes. And with all due respect to Mr. Gill, I felt uncomfortable being told how I should feel about that name on that sign that's up there. Being a woman, I don't feel included by that name.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
So the next two articles should go pretty quickly.
Article 28, Mr. Churchill.
Should go pretty quickly. This is a structural change now. I move to amend the code of North Reading General Bylaw by replacing references to Board of Selectmen with Select Board and Selectmen with Select Board member as specified in Article 21.
On the motion, recommendations for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Crisco.
Board of Selectmen recommend 3-2.
Finance Committee, Ms. Silver.
There's no action required.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 29, Mr. Crisco.
I move to amend the code of North Reading zoning bylaw by replacing reference to the Board of Selectmen with Select Board and Selectmen with Select Board member as specified in Article 29(1).
We have the motion recommendations for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Crisco. Recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Crisco.
Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee.
No action required.
This is a zoning bylaw. The CPC wish to make a recommendation.
The Planning Commission recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Did I hear it? I think I heard a no, so I'll do motion carried. Oh, by declare two-thirds majority. It being past the hour of 11 o'clock, I will entertain a motion to adjourn to a day and time certain. Mr. President.
Mr. Moderator, I move to adjourn to Thursday, June 7th, 2018 at 7 p.m. Daniel H. Shea Auditorium here in North Reading High School on Park Street.
Motion to adjourn. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.